This important topic of policy reform for sustained high growth at your annual sessions this year. As you know, one of my new responsibilities is to specifically look at state-owned enterprises. So state-owned enterprises must be reformed to add value to the economy and to contribute to higher levels of socio-economic growth. To achieve this, the government must create and sustain strong market structures. However, the success of Sri Lanka's depends mainly on the quality and independence of the institutional and governance structures. The domain of good governance is both the responsibility of the public sector and also the private sector. So the question often posed to me is the solution in privatization? In reforming the public sector, there is no conclusive evidence that the ownership change is a necessary or sufficient remedy for underperforming enterprises. Instead, as evidenced by some examples from several countries, from South Africa to Singapore to India, across the South American continent, it is management reform based on the structure of incentives around the realities of the agent or the principal agent relationship that has sometimes worked. In the case of SOEs, the principal agent relationship, where the principal is the general public and the agent is the management of the entity, so the real challenge lies in institutionalizing incentives to firm up the line of accountability between the public and the management. Professor Indraratna, over the last week, I have been sitting long hours reviewing institution by institution public enterprises. And I can say that there is no connection, often there may be some exceptions, between management performance and the outcomes of the enterprise. The spectrum of solutions for SOE reform is not limited to ownership change only. We need to look at the range of solutions available and see how these could be adapted on a case-by-case basis. The various modalities available for public sector reform range from performance contracts to management contracts, private competition, public-private partnerships, and to privatization. For example, the performance of contracts as a strategy for public enterprise reform in Sri Lanka is one that we now need to explore. The essence of performance contracts is to institutionalize effective incentive structures and processes that reward managers and employees. All of us who have had some experience in the private sector know how true this is. As such, performance contracts can be introduced at several levels of public sector management, including board, directors, and senior executives, and also employees. One of the things that is very self-evident to you, and is even more evident to me now, is that the performance contracts of boards lacks in the public sector, but I think there's much to be done even in the private sector in this country. And another modality is to outsource specific management functions to the private sector through management contracts. I can tell you the evidence is that the gap is too big just for us to think of reform what we actually have, and therefore we'll have to take some shortcuts if we need some quick results. Rajya Sansa, Pratisanskarne Kirimedi, Paujali Karne Kirima, Seal Prashnavala, Pati, Ikrama Visuma Noi. Imaatanavala Kariakshamatave, Vedidun Kirimata, Vena, Vivida. ක්‍රමවේද ගණනාවක් භාවිත කරන්න අවශ්‍ය වෙනවා උදාහරණයක් ලෙස මෙම ආයතන රජයේ අංශයේ සහ පෞද්ගලික අංශයේ හවුල් ව්‍යාපාරයේ ලෙස පවත්වා ගන්න යන්න පුළුවන් ඒ වගේම මේ වගේ කලමනාකාරයේ පිළිබඳව ගිවිසුම් හෝ කාර්ය සාධනයේ පිළිබඳව ගිවිසුම් අපේට කරන්න පුළුවන් Like the recommendations for prioritization, without sufficiently unpacking the broader context, may result in perverse distributional impacts and also resistance. Recall the follies of prioritization in Russia, in South America, following the Washington consensus prescription and ideology. We also recall the prioritization failure of the British Railways. On my way to the conference, just googling to see what happened to British Railways, you discover that you have ended up with a more expensive service, a poorer service, large government subsidies, and one of the only beneficiaries appear to be the private sector owners. So in economy, there is no effective competition law or policy, we also need to be careful that a public monopoly may well transmute into a private monopoly with undesirable societal and economic impacts. Pratisanskarana wala pulu prativipakaya adhyayane nokara paugalikaranaya ekama visumda siddhipak kirima haraha ඇතිවන අනිසි ප්‍රතිවිපාක නිසා රාජ්‍ය සංස්ථා ප්‍රතිසංස්කරණය පිළිබඳව මහ ජනතාව තුළ දැඩි අප්‍රසාදයක් ඇති විය හැකියි. Competition must be the principle and the driving force in this space, whether it be within public enterprises or across the public sector or between the public and the private sector. The process of competition also has to be subject to effective regulation so as to facilitate both producer and consumer welfare. And the two often quoted examples in Sri Lanka, one is telecom, and you remember the days, at least I remember the days when I was a child, where you had the telephone which you actually had to, you know, turn a circle to get a number. And I remember the days in which, as a child, we were probably one or two houses who had the telephone, and my mother used to actually padlock the telephone because many neighbors queued up to take a phone call, and the cost was quite prohibitive, and therefore it had to be controlled. So in the telecoms industry, what happened? You introduced partial privatization of foreign equity and management, and then you opened up the space for competition. In contrast, you look at the liberalization of the bus services, a relative failure. Poorer services, less capital investment, and again something in the private sector. There are of course many other reasons too, like price controls and so forth. So to unleash competition in terms of allocated financial and operational efficiency, in terms of public service performance, the crux is strong regulatory governance and institutions. The effectiveness of regulatory institutions, structures and processes are paramount in the success of these enterprises. Currently, regulators' operational independence and accountability is suboptimal, with most of these entities reporting to line ministers. In reality, regulators should come under parliamentary oversight. And I think we have seen this in other countries. For example, in the US, the appointment of heads of competition agencies, the Federal Trade Commission, the Department of Justice, have to be approved by Congress. Also, Congress approves all funding for these agencies. If I were just to say something as a side, we have in the Sri Lankan Constitution certain officers in the Sri Lankan Constitution, for example, the Auditor General. The Auditor General's practical terms of reference, the Auditor General's remuneration, even though it's in the Constitution, is still set by government rather than by Parliament. And therefore, I think that if you really want independence, it must be direct oversight of Parliament in every sense of the word. In India, the EU and in the US, the decisions of competition agencies are subject to judicial review. The Indian Competition Authority also has a revolving door provision. Members of the Competition Commission of India cannot work for an entity or any issues relating to their official duties after they have been relieved for 2 years. The Rajya Sansa Pratisanskarane Kriyavaliye Swadhinathvesa Bhagavima Araksha Kinimata Nan E Kriyavaliye E Vishyabhaga Amitibhaya Kamanar Dhoa Parlimentwe Nirikshane Yatatata Bandhun Kirima Ithamatma Vedatmeno. Furthermore, there are a plethora of regulatory organizations. I remember we had this debate 10 or 15 years ago. And I think we should start this debate again. We have the Public Utilities Commission, named with water, energy, petroleum, and so forth. Telecommunications Regulatory Commission, National Transport Commission, Consumer Affairs Authority, and various financial authorities, as Securities Commission, and many, many others, regulating brokers, stockbrokers, unit trusts, the central bank, which regulates the banking and financial companies, listing establishments, primary dealers, and so forth. There is a genuine need to rationalize some of this to obtain end-user efficiency, financial constraints, and regulatory skills constraints. I'm not prescribing an answer here. I'm only calling into question a debate that was there 10 or 15 years ago, that it's time to relook what we are doing. We need to question the structure. Do we need all these separate regulators? Or can some be sorted under a more umbrella regulated body? One advantage of the umbrella is the creation of an apex to coordinate activities and get economies of scope. However, I return to my point on the absence of comprehensive competition law. As you are aware, the current legal framework embodied in the Consumer Affairs Authority, Act No. 9 of 2003, which provides for institutionalization of the Consumer Affairs Authority, primarily provides for consumer protection. You will recall that previous to that, we had a Fair Trading Commissions Act of 1987 and a Consumer Protection Commission through the Consumer Protection Act of 1979. However, these pieces of legislation were repealed with the enactment of the new law in 2003. What does this mean in practice? That policymakers do not have adequate tools in their arsenal to investigate, deter, and potentially punish anti-competitive practices, both domestic and cross-border. We have situations in which there is a level playing field for the private sector, and then we have requests from the competing government institution somehow or other to exempt them from those regulations. Compare the lack of comprehensive competition law in Sri Lanka with those in the surrounding countries. For example, Pakistan's Competition Authority which was widely perceived as a laggard, is now demonstrating considerable effectiveness. More recently, in 2014, India's Competition Commission slapped ₹6,300 crores fine on the top 10 cement companies in India for cartelization. Under 2000 law, the Consumer Services, Consumer Affairs Authority have the powers to regulate wide range of practices pertaining to exploitative business practices, pricing and competition levels, consumer health and safety, quality health service. But what does actually happen in practice? They are more focused on price controls and services to the exclusion of everything else. Furthermore, there's little transparency on how the authority calculates and establishes price levels. A critical issue that gets inadequate emphasis in the current legislation is the area of consumer rights and the right to information. We have a useful reference here with regards to India's law and South Africa's consumer protection legislation, which provides for a broader array of fundamental consumer rights, not just the right to information, but the right to be heard, the right to be fully informed about the performance and quality of goods and services. The President alluded today to the fact of national industries, and also he alluded to the fact of looking at the gap between our exports and imports. He also talked about agriculture, national agriculture, and he also talked about the health problem that fertilizer and the agricultural belt is prevalent in the agricultural belt, and particularly the areas in which he represented for a long period of his political life, the sensitivity, and really we don't know what we are actually consuming, and we are living with the consequences of that. At the procedural level, the enforcement capacity of the CAA is compromised by weak regulatory governance and the subversion of principles of workable independence, transparency, accountability, and predictability. The institutionalization of management accountability, competition policy, and regulatory quality will drive the process of public sector reform. This will require both substantive and procedural policy interventions. And as the Ministry of Public Enterprise Development, while we focus on the performance management of these public enterprises, there is much to be done in the regulatory sphere. I invite economists here today to become a part of the solution in order to enable sustainable levels of high socioeconomic growth. Your input is necessary. I wish the Sri Lanka Economics Association annual sessions much success. Thank you again for inviting me.